I'm Michael Kirby, and I want to offer congratulations to Canberra on the centenary of its naming as the national capital and of its life at the centre of our country. It's the place where the great political and legal decisions are made, and it's a place where I called it home for the 13 years that I served on the High Court of Australia. In my glory days, they were the happy times, and my partner Johan and I loved living in Canberra and walking around, seeing the stars at night and the beautiful trees during the day, and some of the beautiful people as well. I am apologetic that I cannot be with you on Human Rights Day 2013. I have a good excuse. At the time that Human Rights Day is being celebrated in Canberra and around the world, I am going to be in Geneva chairing the Commission of Inquiry on alleged human rights violations in the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, North Korea. I'll say something about that inquiry and the lesson it has for the global character of human rights in today's world at the end of these remarks. Growing up in Australia, I was often told, and indeed taught, that human rights, or the rights of citizens, were very well protected in our country, that we really didn't have to worry much about it. The elected parliament and the political contests would ensure that the human rights of the citizens were always safeguarded. It has to be said that usually that is probably the case. Ultimately in Australia, we normally muddle our way through our representative electoral democracy to the right human rights respecting outcomes in cases. But it isn't always so, and fair-minded citizens, when they reflect upon our institutional arrangements, will, I believe, see them as very 19th century in some respects. Our constitution was really designed and drafted at the end of the 19th century by gentlemen who travelled to those labours in horse-drawn carriages and had top hats, and there were no women. The women were in the home, minding the kitchen and the children. So the world of today is somewhat different, and I've learned in the course of a long life in society and in the law that our laws and our society don't always respect the universal human rights of citizens and of others in Australia. We don't always safeguard those rights. I was taught that at a very early age, at the age of 10, when the legislation was enacted by the Federal Parliament soon after the election of the Menzies government in December 1949. The legislation was designed to ban the Communist Party, to take away the civil rights of communists and their leaders, and to prevent people adhering to communist ideals. As it happened, my grandmother had remarried, and she married the National Treasurer of the Australian Communist Party. His name was Jack Simpson. At least that was his pseudoname. His original birth name was Morris Flynn. He'd fought at Gallipoli, so he was an authentic hero of the normal values that we have in Australia and New Zealand. And at the end of the war, so disillusioned was he by experience that he became a communist. Then in 1949, the legislation was promised, the people voted for the Menzies government, the legislation was enacted in 1950, but it was challenged in the High Court of Australia. We in our family knew that something pretty terrible was about to happen to the man we called Uncle Jack. He was an idealist, he was a kind man, and he was very good to me and my siblings when we were then young children. And the legislation, when challenged in the High Court, was ultimately held by the court by a majority of five justices to one, Chief Justice Latham dissenting, to be constitutionally invalid. Mr. Menzies took it to the referendum to amend the constitution, to overcome the High Court's decision. But in the end, the people of Australia, by a very narrow margin, upheld the decision of the High Court, refused the amendment of the constitution, and confirmed that the law could deal with the actions of communists, but it couldn't deal with the fact that some people believed in communism and wanted to assert and spread its beliefs. That, I think, was a correct principle of the law to adopt. In any case, it was the law adopted in the High Court in the Communist Party case. It taught me as a little boy how the law is not always just. It isn't always protective of minorities, particularly unpopular minorities. And sometimes we need extra protections. And sometimes those protections are needed from the courts, the independent branch of government, which will decide where justice and the constitutional rights actually lie. Later, as I came to puberty, I found another area of the law which was pretty unfair, and that was the law on gay people. Discovering my own sexual orientation, I came to the conclusion that just because something was the law, and just because it was enacted by a legislature, and just because it was popular with the majority of the people, and just because it was supported, for example, by the churches and by other forces in society, didn't really mean that the law was objectively just, that it was just to all the people, that it was equal justice under law for all. And so I grew up in a society that criminalised and stigmatised and penalised gay people, including myself. And that was a very healthy corrective to my belief that Parliament always did the right thing and that everything was fine in Australia. We didn't really need intervention of the unelected courts and the unelected judges and of a rule laid down in a human rights instrument. As I developed in my legal career, I found that there were many instances like this where the law was unjust, usually affecting minorities. The minority who were Aboriginal, for example, were denied their land rights. They were simply not respected, and very strong decisions of the courts and some legislation of the colonial, state and federal parliament upheld that position. That was not changed until a decision of the High Court of Australia in the Mabo case was decided in 1992, before I was appointed to the High Court. The Mabo decision was actually founded to a large extent on a principle of international human rights law. Justice Brennan, writing the decision for the majority of the court, said that the universal principles of human rights, if it laid down anything, laid down the principle of no discrimination on the basis of race. You could not discriminate against people simply because they were of a different race or ethnicity. And that principle was carried into the Mabo case, and subsequently, when I arrived on the High Court in 1996, it was carried over into the Wick decision, and unsurprisingly, perhaps, I sided with the majority in the Wick decision, upholding the right of Aboriginal Australians to their traditional lands in the vast territories of the Australian continent, which were encompassed by pastoral leases. Another aspect of minorities in my youth was the White Australia policy. And it was to the credit of politicians on both sides of the divide that steps were taken, starting with the Holt government in the 1960s and with the great referendum of 1967, and concluding subsequently with the actions of the Whitlam government after the election of 1972, that the White Australia policy was repealed, the laws on which it was founded were removed. So in that instance, Parliament worked. But in other instances that we all know of, Parliament has not worked or has taken an awful long time to get to the right decision. For instance, in respect of the repeal of the laws criminalising gay people for their sexual conduct, those laws were repealed in South Australia in 1974, but it took a long time for the last of the laws in Tasmania to be repealed in 1997. And this indicates that occasionally, as in the matters of Aboriginal rights, of the rights of free assembly and political belief, the rights of sexual orientation and minorities, and the rights of Asian Australians, sometimes it takes decisions of the independent branch of government to change things. Now, in this matter, the Australian Capital Territory has definitely given a lead to the Australian Commonwealth. The enactment of the Human Rights Act in 2004, based substantially on legislation which had been adopted in New Zealand first and then in the United Kingdom, provides a solution which upholds the supremacy of the legislative branch of government, but gives the courts a role when they conclude that the rights of a minority, normally a minority, have not been properly respected. My own view is that the most important impact of the legislation in the Australian Capital Territory on human rights, which was subsequently copied in the state of Victoria and reaffirmed following the change of government in Victoria last year, that the most important development is not actually in the court decisions that come out of individual challenges. On the contrary, I think the most important way in which this legislation helps in a free society is by promoting the education amongst young children of the values expressed in the Charter or in the principles of the Human Rights Statute. It gives teachers a foundation on which to instruct young people in the basic values upon which Australians live peacefully together. And the other important respect in which the human rights legislation works outside reliance on the courtrooms is in the bureaucracy. If the officials cannot certify that a bill before the legislature is compliant with the human rights measure, then they must indicate that in a certificate. And that requires either that the government or those who are proposing the bill will bring their law into conformity with the human rights measure, or it provides a requirement that the proposer of the legislation will assert that they are aware that the bill is said to be non-compliant with fundamental human rights, but they seek to justify it anyway. That happened in Victoria during the Brumby Labor government in a stop and frisk power which was given to the police. The officials indicated by their certificate that that probably didn't comply with the Victorian Charter. The Brumby government justified the measure, and that then put before the people at a subsequent election the decision on whether to uphold the actions of the government or whether to indicate that they disapproved of a measure introduced to overcome the fundamental rights expressed in the legislation. Now, if we look at our country today, there are particular areas in which the issue of human rights is not arguably adequately fully protected by our democratic process. The democratic process tends to be concentrating more and more in recent times on the battles over the economy, over wages, and over government expenditures. It doesn't tend very often to be fought out on issues of fundamental rights. And that's the way the issues concerning the fundamental rights of unpopular minorities tends to slip through the cracks. The minority such as bikies, the minorities such as refugee applicants, the minorities such as homosexuals and sexual minorities. And it's for the protection of those minorities that sometimes it's necessary to have the actions that are laid down in legislation such as the Australian Capital Territory Human Rights Act of 2004. I congratulate, I applaud, I honour the action of the Australian Capital Territory in adopting these principles. We in Australia are now virtually the only country in the world that does not provide a general statement of fundamental rights in our legislation or in our constitution that can be the subject of instruction in the schools, that can be the subject of action by the officials, and that can be the subject of contested cases in the courts. The justification in public of these issues is a very important aspect of freedom and of fundamental and universal human rights. We have fought in our wars for these fundamental and universal human rights. We've seen too many countries where they have been denied, and it's important that in Australia we should not be too self-satisfied about our system of government, that we should be seeking to learn from other nations, and that we should learn from the actions taken in the Australian Capital Territory and in Victoria in providing this extra leverage, this extra forum in which the fundamental human rights of the citizens can be debated and discussed, but the final decision remains in the legislature. I said at the outset that I would say something about the current inquiry in which I am engaged on North Korea. That will be the reason why I am not with you on this occasion for the celebration of Human Rights Day in Canberra. The inquiry was adopted by the Human Rights Council of the United Nations, and it was adopted following years of concern about alleged human rights infractions by the government of North Korea. The inquiry will be producing its report, and the report will be presented to the Human Rights Council of the United Nations in March of 2014. It will also quite possibly be presented to the other organs of the United Nations, the General Assembly, to which I gave an oral update in October 2013, and possibly a briefing for members of the Security Council. The issue of human rights is closely connected with international peace and security and with economic equity, as was recognised in the Charter of the United Nations when it was adopted in San Francisco in 1945. In North Korea, there are serious allegations about gross starvation of the population, stunting of undernourished children under the age of 5 years, abduction of people, including young children, returning home from school, and their transport to North Korea. Prison camps and detention camps where there are starvation rations and where members of a family are imprisoned with the alleged offender on the basis that the contagion of false political views must be removed from society. The inability to move around their own country or to leave the country, and the inability to get news and information through the internet or through independent news outlets. So many allegations that are now the subject of the investigation by the Commission of Inquiry of the United Nations, which I chair. This is an instance of the way in which the world now lives in a community concerned with universal human rights. This is the world that was established by the United Nations and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, brought into operation by a committee chaired by Eleanor Roosevelt, the widow of FDR, the wartime president of the United States, and gavelled into operation by a very distinguished Australian, H.V. Evatt, a former Justice of the High Court, who was Australia's Minister for External Affairs and Attorney General during and after the Second World War. The world today is not able to resort to gross infractions of human rights behind closed doors. The world today examines every country, including Australia, in universal periodic review to make sure that we conform to international human rights standards that we've signed on to. And that's another reason why we should have our homegrown standards of human rights, so that it's not just in the international sphere, but in our own domestic jurisdiction that we have these principles of human rights that we can teach, that we can uphold, and that where necessary, we can go to court to have the courts rule on whether legislation is disrespectful of minorities, as sometimes it has been. And so, both in national endeavour, in the courts, I have, through my life, sought to uphold those principles in Eleanor Roosevelt's Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And now, in the Commission of Inquiry on North Korea, I am seeking to do so in the international sphere. All of us, all Australians, in our much blessed country, must do this. We must think locally, we must act locally, and we must think and act globally. That is the challenge which was laid down by Eleanor Roosevelt and her colleagues in drafting the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We in Australia must be equal to that challenge, and that means we in Australia must adopt laws which give the foundation in which the next generations of young people can come forward in our country and can realise that the foundations of our society are not brute power, but are the power of ideas and the power of human rights and the power of high moral principles by which we live together in peace and harmony. I extend every good wish to the people of Canberra on the centenary of the naming of Canberra as the national capital. I extend every good wish to all Australians on the celebration of Universal International Human Rights Day, December 2013.